calculated over which thought I should give, and had actually changed my mind. So, well, first of all, I'll say thank you to the organisers for inviting me. I was going to talk about fundamental thoughts and loops and the amplitude of reality. For me, this was a the time which, that work that I wanted to talk about was for me demonstrating that in some sense system theory was coming to maturity, because what it demonstrates is that we can formulate gauge theories on twister space, and we can actually prove things which are harder to prove elsewhere. And and so what we were able to do was to formulate any distortion of the angles as a unwanted transcendence theory with an additional term on twister space, so it's just a field theory on twister space, and we were able to do a much led to a programme whereby you try to understand how to compute Einstein gravity using the Berkeley's looking at the string. And many years ago, I wrote down a, with Chris Powell and others, I wrote down a string theory for that had a degree of freedom of Einstein gravity. But for reasons that will become apparent later, it didn't work. Another approach, of course, is a more what you might call a physicist approach, which is just to guess the answer. And so that was done very recently, just done by Chateau and Skip. So I shall try to get to that formula at the very end of the. Okay, so just to explain a bit more about how to go from conformal gravity to Einstein gravity, it's not enough if you want to calculate some scattering amplitudes to know that a solution to the Einstein gravity equations gives you a solution to the conformal gravity equations, because the S matrix requires a bit more data than that. And roughly speaking, the point is that you need to know what the value of the action is on a classical solution, as well as so it's not enough to know that a solution to one period is a solution to another period. You've got to know that the actions evaluating those solutions agree. And so Mother Singh came up with an argument about a year ago explaining why it is that conformal gravity could be used to calculate Einstein gravity amplitudes in a context in which the cosmological constant lambda is he frames the scissor space to give a nice global problem. And if you modify his argument, so he just normalized lambda to be equal to a third or something, but if you sort of take away that normalization, what you actually discover is that the tree level S matrix for the ball gravity is lambda times the corresponding Einstein S matrix. And the idea is very simple. So if you're just after tree level amplitudes, then the Einstein S matrix is, an S matrix in general can be thought of as the action evaluated on a conservatively constructed field that's given some data, a sum of sort of small contributions at infinity to describe the notation for infinity to a strict time. And so what you do is you take your data, all these little GIs here, or this, and then you find a classical solution G, continuous across the space time, and then evaluate your action on it. And to compute the nth term of the S matrix with n particles, you just look at the coefficients of all the x and i's to the order in the action. So if you take the full gravity action, then I'm going to call it C, and if you take the Einstein action, I'm going to call it paragraph K. So if G is Einstein, and we evaluate the full gravity action on an Einstein solution, then there's a standard topological identity. So if it were compact, you would just say the bar tensor squared is equal to the Euler class, trace three Ricci vanishes. So I'm ignoring normalization constants here. So you end up with lambda squared times the volume. Whereas for Einstein gravity, you get lambda times the volume. So this tells you that the actions are equal up to a multiple of the cosmological constant. And so therefore the S matrix is equal to B2. And this is with the statement that we've used data for conformal gravity that will actually lead to an Einstein solution. Now this argument is far too slick and straightforward, and there's a whole slew. We're actually working in a non-compact context, and in fact this volume is infinite. Needs to be renormalized, but this is a standard procedure, and you can follow through all of the renormalized volumes here and get the right answer. But it's interesting to notice that on the left-hand side, of course, course, what you get is something which is manifestly finite, because this conformally invariant interval doesn't actually know where it is. That formula in itself has already given you a regularization. Okay, so so that's the device we've got to use, but now I have to tell you. Sorry.
What is the dimension for that formal gravity?
So the project of the formal gravity is the Weyl vector square, an integral of the Weyl vector square. Okay, so twister string theory takes place in twister space, and essentially living in twister space in my research life for decades now. But I can see that the audience probably has not, so I have to do some introduction. For twister space, I'm going to use a supersymmetric extension, so this is CT3/4. And usually we set it up so that you have homogeneous coordinates, so four bosonic ones, decomposed into a pair of spillers, one of each type, and four fermionic coordinates. The way that we usually think about twister space in this non-projective format is that it's the fundamental representation of the superconformal group. And but we're really only interested in the projective space, so we push it out by the scaling that goes to CT times. Now, okay, so if you're living in twister space, what does space time look like? So, for a pure mathematician, this is going to be the Klein correspondence. So space-time, at least bosonically, is four dimensions, although you have eight fermionic directions as well. So a point in space-time is going to correspond to a line in twister space. So these coordinates, the coordinates of points in space-time, is 2x2 matrix, XAA prime. And we're using lambda as homogeneous coordinates on the line. And expressing the line as a graph of mu and chi in the function of lambda. Anyway, so you don't need to worry too much about formally. The key idea is that a point in space time corresponds to a complex projective line in space, a ring space. And this actually encodes the formal structure of space time simply by incidence property. So if you have two points that are null connected in space time, then their corresponding lines can set. So, in some sense, the information of space-time is encoded into the global holomorphic structure of twister space because the lines are determined simply by the fact that they're holomorphic in category 1. And then their instance property gives you back the conformal structure of space-time, and the correspondence is conformally invariant. You expect no more at this stage. The fact that space-time events are represented in twister space by a ring and sphere is very suggestive of string theory, because strings do have coiled sheets, and these have to be holomorphic. And so this is it suggests that if you just wanted to reconstruct space time, you would think about space time as arising as a holomorphic map, space of holomorphic maps from the ring and sphere into twister space is really well. And you can write down a twister string theory that does just that. So we have field Z, which is functions on the world sheet, singular coordinates on the world sheet, and Y, which is a 0-1 form, with a 1-0 form. And essentially, Y is going to be a Lagrange multiplier for an action which tells you that Z is holomorphic. So the Y D bar Z is the main part of the action. And I'll set these up non-projectively, and so what we do is we gauge away the scaling. So the A here is just a gauge field, and it's the gauge field reduced to projective space. So this is a simple, probably a simple strict theory as you can hope for, in some sense. I could even miss out gauging about the standard projectivity at the start. And what string theory allows you to do is to And that is telling you about deformations of the complex structure of the twister space. And that's well known, according to Penrose's non-linear graviton construction, to give you self-dual perturbations of the space-time metric. This GDZ is a little bit more serious. It's the section of B field from string theory. And it's dual to S, so it gives you the anti-self-dual perturbations of the conformal structure. But this interpretation of the geometry of twister space is well, I guess, of course, a string graviton. So we have these two types of vertex operators, and we can then use them to calculate scattering amplitudes. So the idea is you do the path integral that's perturbed a bit by those vertex operators, you expand it out, and you end up, after doing a bit of functional integration and whatnot, with an interval of zero nodes. So we get the conformal gravity S matrix is going to be given by an integral over the space of zero nodes of a correlation function of these vertex operators, so we have n vertex operators, so the space of zero nodes is spatial maps of 3D with n mark points in the twister space. And you may throw in some errors here, and that would then give you a formula to work with for the amplitude of conformal gravity. So this is the formula that was injected by Berkowitz and Whitley back in 2004. Now for the tree amplitudes, we take signal to be the real sphere, and so we expect to get just the tree level S matrix when the genus is zero. And we then formalize, so we can make this actually very explicit with the tether zero, because rational maps are actually very easy to describe. We can take homogeneous coordinates on the real sphere, signal 1, and we can expand the map from the real sphere to twister space as a polynomial of 3D in these signals. And the coefficients then are coordinates on the moduli space. So your attention is integrating over all of these coefficients you are, although you have to mod out by the monument GL2 that you've introduced by choosing these homogeneous coordinates. And this GL2 will also, of course, act on the insertion points. And so what's the work involved in actually producing this correlator? So these VS are a string of these the string of these vertex operators here. Now, the GZ is easy. That just doesn't do anything when you do formal correlation function. It just restricts to its value on the world sheets of the zero node. But the Y here has to go. It has negative weight, and it vanishes on the world sheet. So it has to be contracted. So what I had before is Y dot S. The FS replaced by a cross of vector fields, 4,000 some Hamiltonian H that has that weight 2. And the G gets replaced by a one form. The G was a one form, but it has to be an H tilde times tau, so it has to be multiple of this tau. So this is how it works. And so if you want to calculate Einstein amplitudes within the form of gravity, this is how these are the vertex operators that you must use. So if the vertex equivalent of the string correctly gives the form of gravity amplitudes, then according to this Lavoisier argument, C equals lambda n for the where n is the Einstein amplitude, is given by this vertex operational expression integrated over the multiply space script n. So this reduces the calculation that we had before, and there is a less here. A famous relation in twisted string theory was the fact that the degree of the map has to be related to what's known as the MHV degree K. And it's related by saying, so the MHV degree is counting the number of negative velocity particles in the scattering amplitude plus 2, the plus 2 being for some historic reasons. And so the negative velocity ones are the H tildes. And in the Berkowitz written form gravity for the string, this relation is not present, and there are plenty of amplitudes which violate this relation. But it's easy to persuade yourself that if you just want to get gravity, then you have to maintain this relation. There are no non-supersymmetric Einstein amplitudes that survive if this relation is violated, and so the entire irreducible sort of set of amplitudes we would get if you violated this do not contain a single honest gravity amplitude, but it's easy ones do all contain the honest gravity amplitude, so it's useful. Okay, so that was one point, that we need to have the degree of the map to be k plus 1 to get gravity amplitudes, other amplitudes will be spurious. Another consequence of all this is that just from the sort of construction of these vertex operators, these Einstein vertex operators, they were all simply linear in the cross-functional constant lambda. And so that means that this expression here is simply a polynomial degree n in the cross-functional constant lambda. So the So the upshot of that then is that since this is lambda times n on the left, we should actually have that this right hand side vanishes when lambda equals 0. And then if you're interested in computing the Einstein part, then we're going to look at the order lambda part of that expression. And then that will give us, so if you essentially differentiate with respect to lambda, that will give us the Einstein. So I'll just focus on these two cases here. So can we get zero? Can we verify the Berkowitz written conjecture lambda equals zero, when we must get zero on the right hand side? And can we calculate the Einstein amplitudes? Now, in order to sort of do a reality check, we have to convert these formulas to ones which we know and love in the momentum space. And the way to do this is to put in wave functions which correspond to the momentum eigenstates. And so there's a standard choice of these, and I haven't done a formula here, but the key point of the formula is really that it contains the spinner parts of the momentum, the lambda and the lambda tilde, and the lambda tilde is also understood. The So this allows you to check answers. Now, first of all, though, we need to figure out how the cosmological constant is figuring in these formulae. So if we go back to the expression for the vertex operators, we had these taus, these contact structures, as part of the negativeness of vertex operators, and we had these y's, which are part of the positivity of vertex operators. And the only way in which you can get a power of lambda from the answer is if that y contracts with the tau. And the point here is that the infinity system, when they multiply together, lambda times the Fermi delta. So what we can do is we want to look at the order and the zero case. We can just say there will be no such contractions, and and then when we look at the lambda one case, we can just allow one such contraction. So that will give us a way of checking how this works. So now degree zero. This formula is very easy. The degree zero amounts are just points in twister space, and the integral over the moduli is just an integral over the twister space. So you're integrating just a local formula, and that's easily done. And I'll just state here that you get an answer which is easy to identify, and the apparent constant will bond down to the one. So degree one, we have. Now that the maps into twister space are lines, and the maps into twister space are these lines that I talked about before, so they correspond to points of space time, and the integral over the moduli space reduces to an integral over space time. And furthermore, by choosing sort of sigma equals lambda as bits of GLC. So the okay. So the 3-point then we now have with the MHV degree relations that are putting down. We have to have two of these h tilde tau vertex operators and just one of the y of the h. And there is a slight error term in this, but. It's something that one can understand geometrically from the point of view which I follow from this distraction. So the but this error term is so I shouldn't say too much about that. But anyway, the correct answer can be obtained from a geometric distraction, and we do indeed get that form gravity 1-3 amplitude is lambda times the Einstein one, and in this context we get a formula for the which is this standard expression called the 3-point vertex times the momentum certainly delta function, and the extra the sitter correction, that's what this term is, this is in fact just a wave operator in momentum error that's called delta function. Okay, so those are the low-lying examples.
is that the all wires can contract with all possible other objects that are in the correlator, and so you just sum over all of these that j not equals y, and that's the I contribution. Now this looks like a slightly ugly thing because it depends on this side, but it turns out to be gauging variable by momentum conservation. It's independent of this side, so it's actually a nice object, and it has a reasonable interpretation as an inverse soft factor. Anyway, so you have some positive products of these over all I, and so what you get is just for every one of these y dot ph vertex operators, you just get one of these. So you multiply them together. But these terms are generically non-zero. And so that's a problem, because with the Montesano argument told us that the amplitude is meant to vanish at lambda equals zero. So and so you scratch your head. I mean, what's gone wrong? And I think really what's gone wrong here is our interpretation as to how to actually use the Twister string is not quite right. You have to think about what the correlator is actually doing. And the correlator is to a certain extent calculating how it is that this line of Twister space is being deformed by the Bernoulli's operator. And in some sense, this is a tree-level computation. And so you only expect tree-level contributions to where this line is being moved. This should not be a computation. So the resolution then is to only allow final diagrams of the correlation of the connected trees. And that would then restrict you to the fit into that classical picture as to what the amplitude is doing. That doesn't fit very squarely with string theory, which would ask you to really do a quantum computation for this. Okay, so now I'm trying to get the right answer with that consideration, and so the answer is yes. So if only connected trees are allowed for the contractions, the conformal gravity amplitude vanishes at lambda equals zero. And the trick for doing this, so this is actually a complicated calculation, though it's easy if you allowed all contractions. You just looked at all the ways that one of them could contract anything else, and you've got a multiplicative factor, and you can sort of just take them all and add them all up, make it easy. Now you should do some complicated combinatorics. You've got to add up all tree contractions, and so here, so maybe I should say what I mean. I mean, we're working with a correlator that has two H tildes, and then we have n minus two H's, roughly speaking. It has the two negative velocity and the rest positive velocity these are the y dot h's and these are the h to the powers. And what we're going to say is that the pattern of contractions in the correlator should form the connected tree. And each of these has a white dot or open dots has a y in it, and so there's a propagator coming out from that dot, and it can go anywhere. It can go to one of those. And these black boxes don't do much. So we had to try and assemble all possible trees with that kind of structure. And there's a rather nice theorem that allows you to actually sum all these things into one coherent object. And so the this is called, it is an elementary form of the Kirchhoff problem. But it's a matrix tree theorem in the form that I was using. It goes back to a counting formula by Kirchhoff for counting the number of spanning trees. So the point here then is that the sum over tree graphs by all the court cases that we get. And we get the discernment of a matrix, and this is a so-called weighted capacity matrix. And because we're going to have to delete, roughly speaking, you know, there are no vertices from this is going to be n minus 1, this is n. There are no propagators coming out from those. We form an n by n matrix, but we actually delete the n minus 1 from the row and column and take this interpolation. And that will give you the sum over the tree runs. So we draw this master graph that I've drawn over there, and as I've done n minus 2 white vertices for the y's, 2 black vertices for the h tilde's, and And so the point is that we put in these propagating factors from I to J for the ij entry of L. And then the clever trick is on the diagonal, you put in that sum that we had, or minus the sum, for the of the outgoing propagators from the I vertices. So the anyway, so this is the matrix tree theorem. Now, this, what we might, one thing I haven't mentioned is that Andrew Hodges, just recently, a few months ago, broke down a wonderful formula for the tree-level MHD amplitude for gravity, using just such a matrix. So the Hodge matrix is just a little bit different. It's conjugated by these terms here, which we have to put in for the propagator, and by just a diagonal matrix. And so the Hodge matrix is pretty much like the L as I wrote before, but it's now going to be an N by N matrix and defined without any restriction. So phi here doesn't have that I equals N minus 1 N. I tilde ij, I of ej, and this sum here, an I equals j, and there's nothing special about the rows and columns n minus 1 here. What he shows is that matrix actually has cone rank 3, and this has followed from momentum conservation. And so what we discover then is that this determinant, when you, so first of all, this weighted Laplace matrix agrees with the Hodge matrix, which deletes the n minus 1 and nth row, but because this has cone rank 3, it has 3 relations. The terms of this thing will actually vanish, and so you get the right answer, as suggested by Martin Sagan. But what's more remarkable is that now we can actually go further, and we can prove that the full gravity formally work at MHD as well, because what we're now going to say is that for the lambda, one of our propagators here that's going to go with one of the tau. So we're going to have a dotted contraction here between a y from life node there to the other one. And maybe I should go a bit more quickly. So we have one less y to contract to the other stuff. And so the other n minus 3 contractions must connect with the remaining y vertices with one outgoing edge getting I, so n minus 1 already, to the tau. So, anyway, so the matrix tree theorem now has one fewer edge to work with, and so we now have to take a determinant of the matrix where you've deleted row column I, n minus 1, and n, and this now is not trivial. And furthermore, and you have to multiply this by the three-point amplitude, and so furthermore, what you end up with is what is precisely Andrew's formula, which is this three-point amplitude times this reduced determinant of phi tilde. And so we land on the Hodges formula. The remarkable thing here, as far as the Hodges formula is concerned, is that although this looks like it's selected out I, n minus 1, and n, in the way that he formulates it, this is now permutation called cross. Permutation of variance. Okay, so that is the first one of Hodges' formula. And then for KMHV, the propagators just require an extra twist, but you might have done the same thing. But the everything's advised, and we only get we get fewer and fewer propagators because we had fewer and fewer wide of the H vertex operators, and the but then we get a generalization of the momentum conservation equation that shows that this thing has code rank n minus k minus 2, or n minus k minus 3. And so what you get is a generalized Koch matrix which has code rank n minus k minus 3. And so this suggests an extension of the Hodges formula which has these generalized Koch matrices. And you're taking a determinant of the binary, which is leading k plus 3 rows and elements for the. So we get vanishing again, as predicted by Mount, saying that all the land we get the Einstein amplitude with this extra, with this generalized Koch matrix. So I was very pleased about this and went to talk to Freddie Chazzo and David Skiller, and they actually showed me what the true formula is. So what I was just telling you about was that term. And but in fact, it turns out that there's a whole extra term here in the true formula. So, so what you discover is that you sort of do these integrations for these towers, and maybe somehow they can assemble themselves. That those tower integrations can be done; they can be assembled to a matrix, which is in some sense a parity conjugate of the Python. Since I have zero time, I won't say much more about it. But the but the point is that this now that the extra det prime of phi, so the det prime is this reduced determinant divided by some van Gonders. So this is actually what the true formula is, and this now exhibits permutation invariance, and it extends directly to any relation to the gravity. So this formula is an integral over. It is a formula for the full three-level S matrix of any potential supergravity and an integral over a much higher rational curve in the Swiss space of 3D corresponding to the MHD degree of the amplitude. This has been proved. Back parity invariance follows by sort of formal Fourier transform. Factorization follows, and one over Z squared follows. And so you use BCFW recursion to actually prove this formula. So the formula is now clearly true. So, okay, sorry to run over, but so the Berkowitz written twist string, then we've confirmed that twist string is 0 and equals 0 to carve out the Mount Sabor argument, obtain a logical Hodges formula MHD with a subtlety over 3 points, and take part of the Chatham-Skinner formula. But there are many things that we don't know how to do, from the twist string, and we will only ever be able to say the n equals h permutation symmetry is a word of the model and n is all expected to be and it's still a puzzle as to why it is that we're only considering three dimensions. So there's more work that needs to be we need to do more work to understand properly the world of the string. So maybe there's a difference to string that if you don't. So anyway, so I'll I'm the trouble is Yeah, so, I mean, it's problematic to eliminate the conformal homology of Berkowitz, Whittington, and String. I mean, I think what we're seeing here is that Berkowitz, Whittington, and String is already sort of, it's not clear how you should think about the tree level. I think we need a different perspective on what these mathematical structures are doing and how we should think about them. I don't think it's really quite emerging as a standard string theory in the way that we might have wished to have it. I'm sorry, I can't give you a more interesting answer.
Sometime may I use this, you implemented a PCB ADM system for this program. Is that dependent?
Beta gamma systems are very much, I mean, I could have called Y and Z beta and gamma. So it's very, twist string